back on where I've been, the things I wouldn't do again, and the things I left undone. You were right there all along. It's taking time for me to see everything you've done for me. Wouldn't change a single thing when I was learning to believe. You make everything, everything beautiful. 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 Fear and anxiety, what my future holds for me. When I get lost on the road, my Father comes to bring me home. You make everything, everything beautiful. You make everything, everything beautiful. You make everything, everything beautiful. You make everything, everything. In the moments when I don't feel your presence, there's a shadow in my soul. Oh, I will call upon your great name, Jesus. You make everything beautiful. Oh, oh, you make everything, everything beautiful. You make everything, everything beautiful. You make everything. Everything beautiful. You make everything, everything beautiful.
Hello, and welcome to worship. Before we begin, we would like to share a few announcements and invitations. Please be sure, if you have campers, that you checked last week's e-letter about Camp WAPO this summer. Camp is on, and you are invited. This week, our life group that is meeting around issues of culture, race, and justice meets on both Monday and Thursday evening. You are invited to the conversation, and you can contact me for the Zoom link. Our area ministry partners, Hope for the Journey Home and the Christian Cupboard, are busy and active, and you are always invited into involvement there. There are hands-free ways to donate, and there are hands-on opportunities to serve. You can contact any staff to learn more. And now, please pray with me as we prepare our hearts for worship. God, we look forward to the ways you will speak to us this morning and the ways you will speak through us in the week ahead. For all of this, we pray for your strength, your wisdom, your guidance. In the powerful name of Jesus, amen.
Greatest day in history. Death is beaten, you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. Empty cross, the empty grave. Life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. He's alive. Happy day, you wash my sin away. Oh, happy day,
looking face to face, I'm yours, Jesus, you are mine. In this joy, perfect peace, earthly pain finally we'll see. Celebrate, Jesus is alive.
Welcome to Resurrection Lutheran Church. My name is Paul Dean. It's my joy and honor to serve as pastor at Resurrection Lutheran Church in Woodbury, Minnesota. Whenever and wherever you are joining us for worship online, we welcome you as family and friends. We do have some announcements this morning. The first announcement has to deal with some family business that we take care of around this time of year. And that is, we're moving towards our annual meeting where there are some things that we need to take care of, some items that we'll need to vote on, and some information that we're going to be having some discussions around. That annual meeting will be held on Sunday, February 14th at 11:30. And we will have that meeting on site, both in our sanctuary and then also out in the parking lot. We have our radio station band ready to go that you'll be able to tune in your cars. And those that feel a little bit more comfortable being inside, of course, we'll have everything spaced out. And we'll be able to take questions surely from the floor. And then also the floor includes your cars out in the parking lot. And there are a lot more details coming about that, but I wanted to throw that out to you. And then to kind of prime the pump for us, there are some of us in our family of Resurrection that they're way more interested in budget details than others. So we want to be able to offer a couple of times for people to come and gather and discuss and hear the year-end budget details from 2020, kind of the journey we went through. It was an amazing journey, both filled with lots of challenges and then some amazing generosity that we experienced as well as a community. We're going to be having those on January 24th and January 31st, both at 7 p.m. and both online via Zoom. You will need to email me your email address and what time or day and day that you would like to attend. And then I will then email you that Zoom invitation the morning of that meeting. So either January 24th at 7 p.m. or January 31st at 7 p.m. Because we're dealing with some financials, we want to make sure that we can kind of keep the loop as closed as possible. And we'll be sending those invitations to you personally. Well, I'm excited for 2021. We still have a long way to go, of course, as we continue to deal with the pandemic and making sure that everybody's safe. Just want to continue to make sure that you're safe out there and that your health is primary, number one on our minds as we take some steps towards hoping to return in-person worship as soon as we can. Well, we are gathered to worship our God. Let us worship together in song, giving in prayer, and giving thanks and praise to our God.
Give thanks to the Lord, God and King. His love endures forever. He is good, He is above all things. His love endures forever.
One day this week when I was driving home, I saw a rainbow. In the middle of winter, I saw a rainbow. It wasn't raining or anything, but the sun was reflecting off the clouds, causing a rainbow. And it made me think of this week. We're going to talk a little bit about covenants today, and a covenant is an agreement or a promise. And one of the very first promises that God makes in the Bible, or covenant agreement with people, is when He makes a covenant with Noah and all living creatures, and He puts a rainbow in the sky. And God said in Genesis 9:12, it says, "And God said, this is the sign of the covenant I'm making between me and you and every living creature with you, a covenant for all generations to come. I have set my rainbow in the clouds, and it is the sign of the covenant between me and the earth. Whenever I bring clouds over the earth and the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will remember my covenant between me and you and all living creatures of every kind. Never again will the waters become a flood to destroy all life." Whenever the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and all living creatures of every kind on earth. Now, that's one reason why I was thinking about rainbows this week after I saw that rainbow in the sky. But the other reason I've been thinking about rainbows this week is because it's also Martin Luther King Day on Monday. And when we talk about Martin Luther King Day, we talk about Martin Luther King's dream about all people living and working together and being kind to one another. And I love this book called God's Dream by Archbishop Desmond Tutu and Douglas Abrams. And in this book, it talks about how when we live together and are kind to each other, share and love and care for each other, hold each other, play together, laugh together, and know that we are family because we're all God's children, that's how God's dream comes true. And God smiles like a rainbow when we do these things. So there's another rainbow that I think about. God's smile is a rainbow. So as we go to Martin Luther King Day, and we're thinking about all the things that we can do to help each other, let's remember the rainbow as God's smile and God's promise. And let's pray. Dear God, thank you so much for giving us beautiful rainbows. Thank you for Martin Luther King Jr. Please help us to be brave like he was, and help us to be kind even when it's hard, and to love one another. In your name we pray. Amen.
Then Moses went up to God. The Lord called out to him from the mountain. He said, "Here is what I want you to say to my people, who belong to Jacob's seed, for yourselves. What I did to Egypt, you saw how I carried you on the wings of eagles and brought you to myself. Now obey me completely, keep my covenant. If you do, then out of all the nations you will be my special treasure. The whole earth is mine, but you will be a kingdom of priests to serve me. You will be my holy nation. That is what you must tell the Israelites."
We are in a new worship series that's going to bring us from here all the way through to Palm Sunday. My hope is that when Palm Sunday comes around, we're going to be in-person worship. That was my prediction last year when we stopped, but I predicted we'd be back Palm Sunday 2020. Hopefully 2021 is by the time we're back. I believe that is a good time frame for us. The worship series that we're going to be moving into is called Speak. And in lots of different ways, God has spoken to us, and God is still speaking to us this day. God speaks to us hope and love and promise. God speaks to us accountability. And we'll be walking through that worship series through the eyes and the lives of some prophets, but then also some pretty obscure people in the Bible who have had moments where God has spoken to them, and they were able to then speak as well. I remember, on the topic of speaking, I remember a class I had in college. I spent a good amount of time in college. I ended up changing my major my senior year, and I ended up needing to take an additional year. And I remember my fifth year, I wasn't necessarily that excited to be in school, and I had to take some classes that I probably would have taken much earlier. And so I was in these classes with a lot of people that didn't know, and I was kind of the old guy in the class and that kind of stuff. But one of the classes I needed to take was a religion class. And I can't remember the name of it, but it was all about God's movement in the world. And are we going to be a part of God's movement or not? It was a religion class. And there were these two different arguments. Do you work with the symptoms of the issues in society, Or do you try to change the whole thing all around, the whole culture? And so it was a class that was filled with all kinds of discussion. Lots of people were speaking in that class. And there were a group of guys, I knew these guys, a group of guys who were keeping a record of who was speaking in this class. It was a discussion class, so we were usually in a circle in the class, and the professor would ask and then wait for people to talk. And typically in classes like that, there are a couple people that spend a lot of time speaking, and there's a lot of people that don't. And so these guys keeping a record, and they would give them names. They would call them things like Bleeding Heart. There's a couple people who were really, you know, about the change of society. And then you had people that were kind of entrenched, and they gave, I can't remember all the names, but they'd give those people names. And then there was a category called Clueless, and some other categories. So they weren't always very nice categories, but these guys were doing this for the whole semester. I didn't know it until one day I kind of found out and saw what they were doing. And they had created these spreadsheets. They had created these charts, and they would begin to predict who in the class was speaking. So they were having a lot of fun, maybe not with the content, but with the class in and of itself. I actually asked them if I had a category, and I typically did not have a category because either I was coming late again or wasn't in class. Again, I was the old guy and not necessarily interested in that class, but so I think when I did talk, they put me in the Clueless category. And what's funny is one of those guys is still a good friend to this day. And it kind of reminded me of this whole idea that we have a voice in the world. And of course, sometimes, people don't hear it, and sometimes, people judge it. But we have a voice and we speak. And that reminds me of God speaking to us as well. That God has been the original speaker. God spoke first. And God's word then created all of creation. God spoke and the universe came to be. And then God continued to speak. Of course, we can put all these kind of God, this God speak in all different kind of categories, the creative speak, the accountability speak, the kind of speaking that brings new life to people, that brings hope and love and all those kinds of things. But one of the major parts of God speak is covenant. God spoke covenant into God's people. Now, we have lots of examples of God speaking covenant to God's people. We have this covenant in the creation story, right? Of God saying, here's a covenant with you, Adam and Eve. You can eat from anything in this garden. This is where you can live. It's a beautiful place, but just don't eat from that tree. And there is this relational covenant being built between God and God's people, right, in that story. And, of course, we know that the people broke that covenant, and they then no longer could live in there. But there's some other covenants, the covenant to Noah. The covenant that God would never flood the earth again, that God would protect what God had created. And a sign of that covenant was a rainbow in the clouds, right? That was a unilateral covenant. That wasn't something that Noah had to do to prove worthy of that or to keep that. That was just God saying, I'm doing this, my choice, I'm never going to do this again. That's a covenant with you and I. We typically think of the covenant God made with Abraham, and then God made with Moses, more of a relational covenant. You'll be my people. I will be your God. Here are things that I'm going to do. Here are things that you need to do. This relational covenant that God continued to speak into the lives of people. And this is the covenant, maybe one of the most famous covenants in the Bible, where in the book of Exodus, God has gathered God's people. And the first thing that God does is say, here is the covenant. Exodus chapter 19, 3-8. Then Moses went up to God, the Lord, called him from the mountain, saying, "Thus you shall say to the house of Jacob and tell the Israelites, you have seen what I did to the Egyptians. The Red Sea swallowed up the Egyptians and God conquered them. And how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, therefore, if you obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession out of all of the peoples. Indeed, the whole earth is mine," God says, "but you shall be for me a priestly kingdom." That is part of the covenant, right? You shall be a priestly kingdom and a holy nation, which means a set apart nation. So a group of priests who in act, in body, put flesh and blood around God's teachings to be a separate nation, to be a holy nation, one who then is an example for the rest of the world. "These are the words that you shall speak to the Israelites," God continues. "So Moses came and summoned the elders of the people and set before them all of these words that the Lord had commanded him, this covenant." Now God's waiting for the response. This is the people's response to God's end of the covenant, the end of God's deal. "The people also answered as one, everything that the Lord has spoken, we will do." And then Moses reported the words of the people to the Lord, Exodus 19, 3-8. What a covenant, right? What a promise made by God, and then a promise also made by the people. And I just love that. The people answered as one. No one disagreed. You know, no one made the nay side, right? Everything that the Lord has spoken, we will do. That is a major, major covenantal promise. I know that when I am talking with young couples who are not just young, but any couples that are getting married, I tell them to make sure that what they say in their vows is realistic. Because saying to someone, especially the God, everything that the Lord has spoken, we will do, that is a tough deal. Make sure that you can keep your promise. Well, God is not done speaking to Moses, right? Or to God's people through Moses. God continues to speak all the way through the prophets, through some other people that we're going to talk about and lean into through this worship series. God also speaks through King David. God also speaks through the Israelites moving into the time of Jesus, and ultimately through the personhood of Jesus. And then ultimately, God speaks to us through the cross and then on the empty tomb. And that's where we're going through this spring and winter and spring to that. But God also speaks to us in our time. God isn't done speaking. And I've heard God's voice through all kinds of different people in my life. People speaking words of wisdom and speaking words of truth that I can link back to God's word in scripture. And God spoke to me through a very interesting person the other day. Probably like the most of us, yes, I've been tuning into the news, been seeing what's been going on, a lot of shock, a lot of frustration, a lot of worry, a lot of just wondering, how did we get here? And on the radio the other day on NPR, as I was driving actually up to church and then back, there was a radio program that was trying to get people from diverse backgrounds, leaders who had been affiliated with the Democratic Party, you know, the more kind of liberal progressive side. And then you have trying to get people who are Republican, more on the conservative side of things. And they were having a hard time getting people on this show. But one of the people they got on the show was a guy named Arnie Carlson. And I didn't know Arnie Carlson. When I moved to Minnesota in my early 20s, I wasn't paying attention to politics at all. Zero. I was worried about the Texas Longhorns. I was worried about what I was doing. I had no real political idea in my body. I wasn't following at all. But one of the things I thought about Arnie Carlson, one of the things that I've kind of understood that he's about, and of course I may be wrong because I didn't follow all of it, but the impression that I always get from him, especially when I hear him now, is that all while he was a conservative politician working for conservative values, he wasn't very divisive or just didn't fight all the time. And he seemed, especially now, maybe because he's not in office, trying to work for common ground with all different kinds of people in politics. And one of the things that Arne Carlson said, as they were trying to figure out how we've gotten here in this mess in America, where people aren't really talking to each other, they're talking past one another, attacking one another, is that he actually spent a fair amount of time calling out leadership, calling them out, calling them to account, and saying that a lot of the leaders in our institutions worry more about their own position in their institutions or their own position or their own business models, and they're worried about their own stature and all of that versus speaking the truth. And one of the groups of leaders he put on in that group were pastors. He called out pastors for being more worried about their offering coffers than speaking the truth. Now, it hit me. Now, Arne Carlson's not a prophet. I'm not saying Arne Carlson is a prophet, but he was speaking truth. And in many ways, I could hear God speaking through Arne to me going, Paul, you should pay attention. And I did some reflecting. And my worry is not about people being upset with something I say or something I do so that they discontinue their giving. I've given up on that a long, long time ago, because there are people that will make decisions based on whatever, and I can't control that. My worry, more than anything else, is that what I say or do will leave people out in the cold. It will leave them behind. And I would like for us to not always agree on things, but for us to come together. I think that's gospel. One of the things I stood up and shared with Resurrection Lutheran Church 3.5 years ago. Oh, yeah, just we're moving in to the fourth year here, is that I'll always be honest with you, and I was always handle things with care, because it's not about me. It's about who we are together. And so I'm going to spend a little bit of time being honest with you about where I am and what I'm thinking about what's going on in our world. And I shared much of this with our confirmation students and several parents who were on the Zoom call this past Wednesday. It's amazing how our kids are soaking all of this in as they watch some adults behave very badly and other adults kind of stuck in place, and then other adults trying to figure some things out. And so I want to share with you a little bit of what I shared with them. And of course, I've added a couple different things. So as we move forward together, there's a couple of things I think for us to think about. I kind of broken them down to four areas, but to start off with kind of a preface, I want you to know a little bit more about me. I'm not a political guy. I'm not political. I vote. I have my own opinions about things. If you were to find me at some other, you know, venue and you wanted to ask me my opinion and that you didn't know as a pastor, I would share with you who I would vote for. But that's not what I feel like is my role as your pastor. And I'm just not political. I just never throw all my eggs into one or the other basket. And so I want to preface this conversation in that way, because I really want you to hear what I have to say. I don't want to leave anybody behind in this conversation. And then also as a part of that preface, I told our kids, talk to your parents. Make sure you have open communication with your moms, your dads, your grandpas and grandmas. If you have questions, if you have worries, if you have fears, have a conversation. Talk to them. What are they thinking? And they can sit there and go, we don't know either. And that's okay. And so for all the rest of us, I think it's important that we talk to someone about this. If we're worried, if we're frustrated, if we're mad, if we're angry, let's not close ourselves into these silos where we only hear one point of view, or we don't listen to anybody else's point of view. Let's have conversation. So I want to preface this whole conversation I'm about to have with you in those two ways. So the first of these four things, I think, is truth. Truth matters. It really matters. You can't play around with the truth. You play around with the truth for whatever reason. Usually the reason why people play around with the truth is because they want to get their own way, because the truth doesn't support what they want, and they try to convince others. But if you play around with the truth, you're playing around with fire. And that's what we saw last Wednesday at the Capitol, playing with fire. There is a truth. Truth matters. We as Christians claim that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. For us, there is a truth. There is truth in Jesus, that Jesus is the truth. So truth makes a difference. And here's the truth. In this nation we call the United States of America, that's still kind of an experiment, it's an idea, it's still relatively young compared to lots of other nations in the world, we have rules. And we've written down those rules. We've collected these rules in a document we call the Constitution. Now, these rules are much like the rules of a board game, say Monopoly. And if you lose, you can't go back and rewrite the rules to make sure that whatever you did was now made you the winner, no matter how badly you wanted to win. And you cannot, after losing, get so mad that you just flip over the board, make a mess of things, and try to convince other people that you were at the finish line all the time. Truth matters. It makes a difference. There are established practices, norms, traditions that mean something, that people have given their lives for, that members of my family have served in the military for, who have gone into war for. And we call all of these collections of established norms and traditions, we call these laws. Laws that keep us safe. Laws that keep our society safe. Laws that keep our communities together. How this works out in our spiritual lives and in our Christian lives, in Lutheran speak, we call it the first use of the law. That the first use of the law is to help keep us safe. All of us safe. And as Christians, we're called to follow them. And what is we saw this past Wednesday on January the 6th is a lot of people who were lawless at the U.S. Capitol. A lot of people were lawless. They didn't believe the law applied to them. And what we're seeing in the aftermath, that there are a whole lot of people who are now finding out that the law is real, because people are enforcing those laws, and they will continue to do so. As Christians, we believe in accountability. We believe that truth matters. Not just we want what we want to be true, but what is true. I told our confirmation kids that there were some adults, yes, that have behaved very badly over the last week or so. And that's happened over our history of humanity. But there are other adults, many, many more of them, who will hold them accountable to the law. The reality is that, yes, you can get mad. You can get mad. But you can't flip over the board and walk away and make a mess of things. Truth matters. A second piece. Well, what do you do when you get mad and want to change something? There's a process for that. It's called organizing. It's called working for change. And in my opinion, working in a nonviolent way for change. I know there's a lot of people that are comparing the Capitol riots to Black Lives Matter marches. And that's just not the same thing. Yep, certainly there were riots. There were buildings that were burnt. There were lots of property that were destroyed. But the vast majority of the people that have walked and have worked for justice for brown and black people in this nation were peaceful. There is a difference in both of these movements. And so if people are mad, organize nonviolently for change. There's a reason why we call this weekend and have a holiday for Martin Luther King Jr. There's a reason why we have it. Because he and many other people, seeing a long and terrible break in the covenant of equality that God has called us all to, they organized. They even were beaten. They absorbed the violence, like John Lewis, like Rosa Parks, like so many others who worked for change. There's a reason why we have an MLK day. There's a reason why I told the kids why they don't go to school on that day. There's a reason why, because we celebrate that change. And we also celebrate and we remind ourselves of the changes that still have to come. And there's also a reason why this past week's event at the Capitol will not get a holiday. It won't be a holiday. I told the kids, you're not going to get January 6th off. No one ever is going to remember this as a holiday, as a reason to celebrate, because it's a stain. It's a stain that needs to be cleaned. So yeah, if you find injustice in the world, gather, organize nonviolently, and with truth, work for justice. The third thing I encourage people to do is what we talked about last week, is to pray yourselves into gratitude. When you find yourselves in that mode, at the end of your rope, you're really worried about what's going on in the world, and you really wanted one leader over the other. And again, it happens throughout history, right? The United States flip-flops all the time. You know, how do you go from you know, Bush to Obama to Trump to Biden? We're flipping and flopping constantly. So many people are in just, you know, on cloud nine, and then the next time they drop down to the bottom. How do we level ourselves out? Well, we pray ourselves into gratitude. Gratitude. What are we grateful for? What do we give thanks for? Instead of thinking about what we don't have or what didn't work for us, what is working? What are we grateful for? And then the fourth and the last, and I think it's probably the most important, and I think it may be the hardest one for us to do, because our identity is wrapped up in so many things. Our identity is wrapped up into red or blue or Vikings or Packers or, you know, any kind of sports teams you want to throw out there. Our identity is wrapped into what state we live in, what ethnic group we're a part of. Our identity is wrapped up into all kinds of things, what clothes we wear, what car we drive, what foods we, I mean, you can name anything. We wrap our identity with it. We shove ourselves into these earthly material things that won't last. Remember who you are. We are Christians. We claim Jesus as Lord. Like I said before, politics will change. It'll change like the wind. people who voted for blue last time will vote for red next time and vice versa, and elections after election after election. History proves politics as limited and as flawed as humanity. This is true, and why God cautions us against placing our trust in the wrong places. This is what God says to us in the book of Ephesians. We must no longer be children tossed to and fro and blown about by every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness and deceit and scheming. But speaking the truth in love, we must grow up in every way into Him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by every ligament with which it is equipped, as each part is working properly, promotes the body's growth in building itself up in love. You see, our allegiance, our worship, our fealty, our loyalty, our hearts, our love belong to our Lord Jesus. Let me say that again. Our allegiance, our worship, our fealty, our loyalty, our hearts, our love belong to our Lord Jesus. Jesus is Lord, not a political party or a political leader. Yes, we can be excited or disappointed if our candidate wins or loses. We place our morals and values on all kinds of things that we want. But keep this perspective. This will pass. What won't pass is what we do with our lives. You are the difference that matters. In your day, every day. And how you follow your Lord matters. How you love matters. How you build up the body of love matters. In the scripture text, it talked about the whole body is joined and knit together by every ligament. Well, we've got some strains, we've got some pulls, we've got some blown ACLs, we've got some issues in the body, and we've got to begin to heal. And I think one way for us to do that is to stop placing people into categories. You know, it was fun to place those people into categories back in college, but we're in real life. We're not categories. We're a lot more complicated than red or blue or conservative or liberal. We're a lot more complicated. And when we do that, we're no longer connected as the body. We're not just labels on a spreadsheet or on a chart. We're the body. And it's time for us to build it in love. Amen.
All this pain, wonder if I'll ever find my way. Wonder if my life could really change. Thank you. out of the dark. Oh, you made beautiful things. You made beautiful things out of us.
Let us pray. God, today we are grateful for the covenant that you have made with creation. You care deeply for your people. And we are excited about diving into this new series about learning about the different prophets in the Bible. Each week, may we learn and grow deeper in our faith as we learn about a different prophet each week. And God, we give you thanks for Martin Luther King Jr. and the gift that he was and is to us today. This week, as we celebrate his life, may we give you thanks for the ways that he brought reconciliation, was a voice for equality of all people, and taught to love our neighbor well. And God, give us the courage to love well this week. And at this time, during the moment of quiet, please lift up your prayers to God as he is listening. We pray all of these things in your name. Amen. Okay. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Go in peace and live resurrection.
Back on where I've been, the things I wouldn't do again, and the things I left undone, you were right there all along. It's taking taken time for me to see everything you've done for me. Wouldn't change a single thing when I was learning to believe. You make everything, everything beautiful. 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 And anxiety, what my future holds for me. When I get lost on the road, my Father comes to bring me home. You make everything, everything beautiful. You make everything, everything beautiful. You make everything, everything beautiful. You make everything, everything. In the moments when I don't feel your presence, there's a shadow in my soul. Oh, I will call upon your great name, Jesus. You make everything beautiful. Oh.